Good afternoon and Jai Hind, dear children. Today we are going to discuss chapter 9 of your English literature book, and the name of the chapter is Raising Scorpions, as you all can see that here. And it's an extract from an autobiographical work, My Family and Other Animals, written by Gerald Darren. And I hope you all have seen the video that I have uploaded where I have discussed about the author, and I have also asked all of you to share with me the names of your pets if you have any. And let me introduce you to the family members of Gerald Darren, because I will come across all these names which I will read the chapter. So family members are first mother and then brothers, Larry, Hesley and Gerald. Larry is the eldest brother, and then there's one sister and her name is Margot. Maid, Lucrezia is the maid, okay? And there's one dog, a pet dog of Gerald Darren, and its name is Roger. So, let's get started. So, the shyest and most self-effacing of the whole community were the most dangerous. You hardly ever saw one unless you looked for it. And yet, there must have been several hundred living in the cracks of the wall. Slide a knife very carefully under a piece of loose plaster and lever it gently away from the brick. And there, crouching beneath it, would be a little black scorpion, an inch long, looking as though he were made out of polished chocolate. So the first paragraph is only about the scorpions. So here we'll come to know that the scorpions are very shy, okay? They just keep themselves to themselves, and they live in the cracks of the wall. That is why it is not easy to find them everywhere, okay? So if you really want to see them, you just have to slide a knife blade in the cracks of the wall, just move the plaster a little away, and then you will find that there are so many tiny scorpions living in the cracks of the wall. Okay, and their bodies, the skin, okay, their skin, it looks like polished chocolates. It's so shiny and dark. Okay, they were weird looking things with their flattened oval bodies, their neat crooked legs, their enormous crab-like claws, bulbous and neatly joined as armor, and the tail like a string of brown beads ending in a string like a rose horn. And they have crooked legs. They are bent a little, okay? It's not straight, and you'll find that they have crab like claws, and they have a string, and it looks like a rose horn, and they are very dangerous, okay? The scorpions would lie there quite quietly as you examine him, only raising his tail in an almost apologetic gesture of warning if you breathe too hard on him. If you kept him in the sun too long, he would simply turn his back on you and walk away, and then slide slowly but firmly under another section of plaster. So here we came to know that the scorpions, they are not dangerous unless you, you just try to harm them. Okay, and even if you are keeping them, under the sun and if it's very hot, okay, then they would not attack you. They would just move away from that place and they would just go back to the place they have come from. Okay, they are not going to attack you, right? Or they are not going to sting you, right? I grew very fond of these scorpions. I found them to be pleasant, unassuming creatures with, on the whole, the most charming habits. And Gerald Darren, we know that he was fond of almost every animal, and he found the scorpions to be very modest, and they were very charming. They were having very charming habits. If you did nothing silly, with them, they are not going to cause any harm to you. Okay, this was very clear. Now, the scorpions always treated you with respect. They are not going to harm you. They are not going to sting you. I grew very fond of these scorpions. I found them to be pleasant, modest creatures with, on the whole, the most charming habits, provided you did nothing silly or clumsy. The scorpions treated you with respect, their one desire being to get away and hide as quickly as possible. So we came to know that if you are not going to do any harm to the scorpions, they will also not harm you. Okay, and they are very shy creatures that we all know now. Okay, they must have found me rather a trial, for I was always ripping sections of the plaster away so that I could watch them, but capturing them and making them walk about in jam jars so that I could see the way their feet moved. So General Dalip was very interested in knowing more about the creatures. So he was always ripping the plaster off the wall, and because he wanted to know more about the scorpions, how they how they live, what are their habits, what do they eat. Okay. And it kind of tested the scorpion's patience. By means of my sudden and unexpected assaults on the wall, I discovered quite a bit about the scorpions. So he did every possible thing to know more about the scorpions. He was always ripping the plaster off the wall. Okay, and so he came to know a few things about the scorpions that I'm going to share with you right now. And they were they would eat blue bottles. Blue bottles are kind of insects. Grasshopper, moths and lacewing flies. Several times I found them eating each other, a habit I found most distressing. So they were, the scorpions eat so many insects, but in case if they don't get any, so they eat each other, and that's really distressing. By crouching under the wall at night with a torch, I managed to catch some brief glimpses of the scorpions' wondrous courtship dances. I saw them standing clasped, their bodies raised to the skies, their tails lovingly entwined. So you can see here, you can observe here that even at night, General Daryl, he was just not sleeping. He just wanted to know more about the scorpions. So he was always holding a torch and peeping, into the cracks of the wall, that what is going on there. And then there he observed that, he observed the courtship dances, and seeing that I was not going to extinguish the light, they would turn around and walk firmly away, claw and claw, side by side. So when the scorpions used to think that this child is not going to extinguish the light, then they would just walk away, because as I told you, they always prefer to live in dark, and they never wanted to be seen by the people. Okay, so they don't want to be seen by the people. They were definitely beasts that believed in keeping themselves to themselves. If I could have kept a colony in captivity, I would probably have been able to see the whole of the courtship, but the family had forbidden scorpions in the house despite my arguments in favor of them. So because General Daryl could never see their courtship dances, and he wanted to see that more, so he tried to convince his family also about it, so that he can, for keeping few scorpions in his bedroom so that he can watch them grow and their habits, as I shared with you just now. But nobody supported this idea. Then one day I found a fat female scorpion in the wall, wearing what at first glance appeared to be a pale fawn fur coat. Closer inspection proved that this strange garment was made up of a mass of tiny babies clinging to the mother's back. So one day, and it was we can say that it was a lucky day for General Daryl. Okay, one day he found that there was a fat female scorpion, and it appeared that it seemed that the scorpion was wearing a pale fawn fur coat, but that was not the fact. When he observed the scorpion closely, then General Daryl realized that it is not a pale fawn fur coat, but it is actually so many small scorpions clinging to the mother's back. Okay. I was enraptured by this family, and I made up my mind to smuggle them into the house and up to my bedroom so that I might keep them and watch them grow up. So, and General Daryl was so fascinated with all that, so then he decided that I am going to secretly keep them in my bedroom and surely watch them grow, because they were very tiny, scorpion babies. And within finite pair, I maneuvered the mother and family into a matchbox and then hurried to the villa. And then what happened, he thought that he had an empty matchbox, and then he guided the mother scorpion into the matchbox. He shut the matchbox and then he ran back towards his home. Okay, and after that what happened, it was rather unfortunate that just as I entered the door, lunch should be served. However, I placed the matchbox carefully on the mantelpiece in the drawing room, so that the scorpion should get plenty of air, and made my way to the dining room and joined the family for the meal. And then what happened, the time he entered his home, then he was called for lunch. he thought that, you know, he should keep this matchbox in which there were so many baby scorpions and the mother scorpion as well. And he kept that on a mantel piece in the drawing room because it was very airy, and he thought that, you know, the scorpions would get sufficient air. And then he ran towards the dining room, dawdling over my food. So he was just eating his food very, you know, very slowly. He was not eating it with interest, and feeding our dog Roger surreptitiously under the table and listening to the family arguing. So this is, you know, this is the dining room where all the family members are sitting together and they are having their lunch. The dog Roger, okay, is sitting under the table, and he was, Gerald is not eating, you know, his food with lot, like with interest, and then he is feeding it to the dog sitting under the table. Okay, under the table and listening to the family arguing, I completely forgot about my exciting new captors. So he just forgot what he has, you know, what he has kept in the matchbox and which is kept in on the mantelpiece. At last, Larry, having finished his meal, and as I told you, Larry is the eldest brother. So he went to buy that. Okay, he went to buy that. He went to get that matchbox there, and then he went to the drawing room, and then he found that there was something else that he wanted to do there. So Jerry forgot about that, you know, matchbox entirely, and Larry, he just stood up, and then he went to the drawing room to pick up that matchbox, and he also opened that matchbox. Let me tell you that. Now I maintain to this day that the female scorpion meant no harm. So Gerald knew, okay, and to this day also, I mean to that particular time also, he believed that, you know, the scorpion meant no harm to anyone. It did no harm to anyone. And she was agitated and truffle annoyed at being shut up in a matchbox for so long, and so she seized the first opportunity to escape. So what happened, the time Larry opened the matchbox, and you know, that actually annoyed the mother scorpion. Because she has, you know, she was being shut up in the little matchbox for so long, and there were so many babies were also there. So it was, you know, really annoying for her, and she really got very angry, and so she seized the first opportunity to escape. Okay, and the time the matchbox, you know, was opened by Larry, she just ran out of it, and then she started crawling on Larry's arm. And she hoisted herself out of the box with great rapidity. Means she, the scorpion was, you know, very quick. Her babies clinging on desperately and scuttled onto the back of Larry's hand. There, not quite certain what to do next, she paused, her string curved up at the ready. Larry, feeling the movement of her claws, glanced down to see what it was. And from that moment, things got increasingly confused. So what happened, the time Larry opened the matchbox, the you know, the scorpion started crawling on Larry's arm, and till that time, you know, Larry didn't notice that there was a scorpion with so many baby scorpions on his arm. But the time when he felt that there's something crawling on his arm, when he, you know, looked down, then he found that there was a scorpion. Okay, and he uttered a roar of fright that made Lucrezia or maid drop a plate. So the time he realized that there is a scorpion on his arm, he shouted, okay, very loudly. And after that, what happened? Lucrezia, okay, the maid, she just dropped a plate in panic and brought Roger out from beneath the table, barking wildly. So Roger also, when he heard this, you know, scream from Larry, then he thought that, you know, there is the family is under any kind of attack. So he thought, you know, he was also a responsible member of the family. Okay, I'm using he instead of it because you will come to know why. So it came out of, you know, from beneath the table, and then it started barking loudly because he thought that the family is under some kind of attack, and he is also a responsible person, and not person, he's also a responsible dog, so he should, you know, save everyone. So he started barking loudly. Okay, that's all he could do at that time. Now, after that, what happened? With a flick of his hand, he sent a fortunate scorpion flying down the table, and she landed midway between Margot and Leslie. Skeleton babies, as she thumped on the cloth, thoroughly enraged at this treatment, the creature sped towards Leslie. Her sting quivering with emotion, Leslie leapt for his feet, overturning his chair, and flicked out desperately with his napkin. So what happened when Laddie came to know that there was a scorpion on his arm? So he flicked his hand, and that made the scorpion land on the dining table. And remember that all the members are still sitting, okay, and they are having their lunch. But the time the scorpion landed on the dining table, and it created a chaos. Now after that, what happened, Leslie? It started when he found that a scorpion is coming towards him. He used a napkin to push it away, okay, and overturning his chair because he jumped up, and that made his chair fall, okay. And who promptly let out a scream that any railway engine. Martha was also continuously shouting, and mother completely bewildered by this sudden and rapid change from peace to chaos. And mother was not knowing what is happening, but she was not wearing her specs, okay. And then she was in a lot of confusion that what is going on. All of a sudden, like, everything was peaceful a moment before, and what has happened all of a sudden here? Put on her glasses and peered down on the table to see what was causing the pandemonium. Pandemonium is a chaos or confusion. So when she wore her glasses, then she observed very closely that what is going on and what is it that has created a lot of chaos here. Now, at that moment, Margot, in a vain attempt means in a useless attempt. So Margot was also trying to keep the scorpions away from herself. So what she did is she just splashed a glass of water, okay, or hurled a glass of water on the scorpion. But it was of no use because the scorpion it was unaffected by that, and all that glass of water did was it soaked the mother who was sitting there. The shark missed the animal completely but successfully drenched mother, who, not being able to stand cold water, promptly lost her breath and sat gasping at the end of the table, unable even to protest. So now when she was soaked in water, then she because she couldn't stand cold water, it made her feel uncomfortable, and then she just sat down, okay. She was gasping, okay, and then she sat down and she was unable to protest even, okay. The scorpion had now gone to ground under Leslie's plate, while her baby swarmed wildly all over the table. So just imagine what a situation it was, where so many scorpions are just crawling on the dining table, and it is not something very pleasant to experience. Roger is the pet dog. He was mystified by the panic, but determined to do his share, ran around and round the room, barking hysterically. And what Roger was doing? Barking. Okay, that's what all dogs do. So he was, the dog was barking hysterically. And it's that bloody boy again, I bellowed Larry. So Larry shouted that this must be done by Jerry, okay, or Jared only. Look out, they're coming, screamed Marco, and Marco was still, dealing with the scorpions. Okay, and then she warned Larry that the scorpions are still coming towards us. All we need is a book, roared Leslie. Don't panic, hit them with a book. And then Leslie said that, hit them with a book, okay? There is no need to panic, just bring me a book so that I can hit them and kill them. What on earth's the matter with you all? Mother kept imploring, mopping her glasses. And still the mother was in confusion that what is going on here. Okay. Mother kept imploring. She just kept on begging for, to know that what is actually going on here. It's that bloody boy. He'll kill the lot of us. Look at the table, knee deep in scorpions. And then he told, the mother that there are so many scorpions crawling on the dining table, and it's all because of Jerry. Now, stop screaming and get a book, for God's sake. Your boss and the dog. Shut up, Roger. So at that time, Margo, she started shouting that Roger was, the dog was, it was continuously barking. So Malu got angry and then she was asking for a book, but Roger was not bringing a book. Instead, it was just barking. Okay. And oh, shut up and get me a book or something. But how did the scorpions get on the table, dear? That bloody boy. Every matchbox in the house is a death trap. So now mother came to know that even there are scorpions on the table, and then she asked that how come the scorpions are here all over the table. So after that, okay, look out, there is another one, quick. And then Marco said that there are so many scorpions and one is coming towards us. Oh, shut up and get me a book or something. But how did the scorpions get on the table, dear? So mother asked that how come so many scorpions are here on the table. And then that bloody boy, every matchbox in the house is a death trap. And then Larry told his mother that it's because of Jerry that he kept a scorpion in the matchbox, and now you can't be sure whether you will be safe after opening a matchbox. Look out, there's it's coming towards me. Quick, do something. Hit it with your knife, go on, hit it. And then everybody was just trying to kill these scorpions and was trying to, keep him or herself safe. Since no one had bothered to explain things to him, Roger was under the mistaken impression that the family were being attacked and that it was his duty to defend them. So no one, told Roger actually what's going on here. And then he found that everybody is, very stressed and everybody is very confused. So he thought that, the family were being attacked. So the dog was, it just kept on barking. As Lucrezia was the only stranger in the room, he came to the logical conclusion that she must be the responsible party. So he bit her in the ankle, and this did not help matters very much. And what happened? The dog, it came to a logical conclusion because nobody told the dog that what's going on. So he decided that Lucrezia, this maid, is the only outsider, and she's a non-family member, so she must be responsible for what is going on here. So the dog bit her in the ankle. Okay, by the time a certain amount of order has been restored, all the baby scorpions had hidden themselves under various plates and bits of cutlery. Eventually, after impassioned pleas on my part, backed up by my mother, Leslie's suggestion that the whole lot to be slaughtered was quashed. Okay. So what happened, Larry wanted all these scorpions to be killed, but he requested, Gerald requested everyone that, no, there is no need to kill these scorpions, and because he was the one who brought them in here. While the family, still simmering with rage and fright, retired to the drawing room, I spent half an hour rounding up the babies, picking them up in a teaspoon and returning them to their mother's bath. So everybody just left the dining table and they all retired to bed for their afternoon nap. And what Gerald do, he was just, he picked up a spoon and then he started picking up the baby scorpions back, like on the mother's back. And then I carried them outside on a saucer and with the utmost reluctance, released them on the garden wall. So he picked all of them on a small plate. And he was unwillingly, he just unwillingly took all of them out and then released them on the garden wall. Roger and I went and spent the afternoon on the hillside, for I felt it would be prudent, it would be like wise to allow the family to have a siesta before seeing them again. So when we moved out, with Roger, then he thought that it would be wise that I and Roger stay here, on the hillside, for a little longer, because it would be good for the family to relax and have their peaceful afternoon siesta, or afternoon nap. The results of this incident were numerous. Larry developed a phobia about matchboxes and opened them with the utmost caution, a handkerchief wrapped around his hand. Lucrezia limped round the house, her ankle enveloped in yards of bandage. For weeks after the bite had healed, and came round every morning with the tea to show us the scabs were getting on. But from my point of view, the worst repercussion of the whole affair was that mother decided I was running wild again and that it was high time I received a little more education. So just see what happened. Eventually, Larry, okay, he developed a phobia. So whenever he used to open a matchbox, he always covered his palm with a handkerchief. So that time, by chance, a scorpion comes out of the matchbox again. His hand would be saved, or his hand would be safe. And after that, Lucrezia, I hope you all remember, okay, she's a maid. And she covered her ankle with, you know, yards of bandage. And she always, whenever she bought tea for the family member, she always, you know, removed the bandage. She showed everyone that, you know, how these scars are, okay. Or she used to show the dry skin, okay, that grows up wherever we have wound, okay, after that. And eventually, the mother decided that, you know, Jerry is getting wild again. And it's high time, it's the, you know, right time that we should do something about him. So that's all we, you know, that's all for today. And that is the story. I hope you all liked it. And thank you so much. Bye-bye.